We usually tend to use the terms member and shareholder interchangeably. But is a member always also a shareholder? And vice versa, that is a shareholder always also a member of the company? Well, this is precisely the question that is going to be addressed in this particular lecture. First and foremost, you need to know that as per Section 118 of the Companies Act 2017, any person who subscribes to the Memorandum of Association is going to be presumed to have agreed to become a member of that company by reason, that is by virtue of that subscription. However, as regards this particular category, always remember that a subscriber to the memorandum does not end up becoming a member of that company until and unless that company gets incorporated. So to put it very simply, you do not automatically become a member the very moment that you sign that memorandum of association. But instead, as the sentence very clearly states over here that you can see on the slide, that you become a member on its registration. So basically, its registration basically refers to the company itself. So as soon as the company gets registered, then these people who have subscribed to the Memorandum of Association are going to become members automatically as a result of the registration process. And let me add one point here, that is, all those people who subscribe to the Memorandum of Association don't only end up becoming members as soon as the company gets incorporated, but also remember that as a result of that incorporation, that is one of the effects of incorporation, one of the effects of registration is also that the subscribers to the memorandum also become holders of the initial shares in the company. So this simply means that the effect of registration is that not only do the subscribers end up becoming members, but they also end up becoming shareholders. So a subscriber to the memorandum is going to be a member of the company as well as a shareholder. So as far as the subscribers are concerned, they are going to become both members as well as shareholders. That is, the terms can be used interchangeably in this context. Because as soon as the company gets incorporated, that is, the certificate of incorporation is issued by the registrar, the effect of registration as stated in section 118, as you can see on the slide right now, is that these people who subscribe to the memorandum become members on its registration. But also, as per section 18 of the Companies Act 2017, which I have not reproduced here, but I'm telling you that basically section 18 lists the effects of registration, and one of the effects is also that the subscribers end up becoming holders of the initial shares, which obviously means that they become shareholders. So yes, the subscribers to the memorandum, in short, are going to become members plus shareholders once the company gets incorporated. Okay, so that's pretty much it about the first part of section 118, which you can see on the screen. Now let's move on to the other two parts that is mentioned in A and B. Because as you can see, the first sentence goes on to say, and every other person, dot dot dot, blah blah blah. So we have to consider other possible situations where people can be considered as either members or shareholders. So basically the first part is not the end of the story. Okay, so other than the subscribers, who else can be considered as a member or as a shareholder or as both? Okay, so let's look at part A first, which states that a person to whom is allotted or who becomes the holder of any class or kind of shares. Now, this is where things can get complicated. So listen to this part carefully. First and foremost, notice that a person can become the holder of shares through a mere transfer, that is, the share certificate itself is transferred from one person to another person. However, the relevant transfer process, that is, the formal process to transfer shares, has not been carried out. So this person who becomes the holder of the shares is not going to be a member of the company until the transfer is actually entered in the register of members. Because always remember one thing, that by definition, any person who wants to be counted as a member of the company has to ensure that their name is entered in the register of members of the company in order to become a member of that company. And basically, this register of members includes every single detail about the member, like the name, their address, occupation, date of becoming a member, and so on and so forth. And this particular point is also stated clearly in the section that I have shared on the screen. So if you read it carefully and completely all the way till the very end, you will see that at the end of clause B, it goes on to say, and whose names are entered in the register of members are members of the company. So whenever you read clause A or clause B, you have to make sure that you read clause A all the way till the very end. That is, with clause A, you have to read that very last sentence that I just read out. And then again, with clause B, I will explain that in a moment, you have to make sure that you also read that very last sentence that tags along at the very end. Because if you do not do that, then you end up thinking that anybody who gets certain shares in the company is going to be deemed as a member. Is that true? Well, no, it's not. Why? Because just becoming the holder of the shares is not enough. You have to ensure that your name is also entered in the register of members in order to be counted as a member of the company. So always remember that it is possible that you get shares of a company by way of transfer, and unless and until the transfer is not recorded by the company itself, that is, the entry of the name has been made and the name of the transferee has been entered in the register of members. And before we move on to clause B, let me point out another very important point related to clause A. So there can also be a situation where the person who has transferred shares to somebody else has made the transfer, that is, has actually handed over the relevant share certificates to another person. And like I said, until the transfer is officially and formally recorded by the company, that person who comes to hold the shares is not automatically going to become a member of that company until and unless the relevant transfer process has been officially recorded in the register of members. So think about what happens to the person who has now given away the shares. Is he going to continue to be a member of the company? Obviously yes, because as long as his name is not struck off the register of members, he will continue to be a member of that company. However, is he also going to be a shareholder of the company? Well, think about it for a moment. This person no longer holds any shares in the company. Whatever shares that he did hold, he has given away to somebody else in return for a sum of money. So even though that other person has not yet become a member and you yourself continue to be a member of that company, but since you do not hold any shares in that company, you are obviously not going to be counted as a shareholder anymore. So therefore, to put it very simply, just remember that the transferor of shares, that is the person who transfers shares to another person, is now going to lack shareholding. And even though he or she may continue to be a member, but until and unless the relevant entries are made in the company's register of members regarding that transfer, that person is not going to be counted as a shareholder anymore, even though that person continues to be a member. So in the context of clause A, I hope you can understand and appreciate the fact that it is possible for a person to be a member and not be a shareholder, and it is possible for a person to be a shareholder and yet not be a member of that company. And now let's look at clause B. This one is actually pretty simple. We all remember from earlier lectures that it is possible to have a company that does not have share capital. So in this situation where a company does not have share capital, obviously there are not going to be any shareholders. So if I were to ask you, in the context of a company not having a share capital, is it necessary that the member is also a shareholder? Well, the answer is a straightforward no. And even to be counted as a member in that company, once again, the condition is that that person's name has to be entered in the register of members. So as far as clause B is concerned, once again, the terms cannot be used interchangeably at all. That is, the term member cannot be used interchangeably with the term shareholder in the context of a company which does not have a share capital. So by way of conclusion, I'm just going to state that the two terms cannot always be used interchangeably.